नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू नीलकंठ ऑनलाइन क्लासेस। आई एम कंटिन्यूइंग सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ क्लास 11 चैप्टर फर्स्ट ऑफ एनसीईआरटी साइकोलॉजी। दिस वीडियो इज बेनिफिशियल फॉर ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स परसुइंग साइकोलॉजी इन 11th क्लास। दिस वीडियो इज ऑल्सो बेनिफिशियल फॉर स्टूडेंट्स परसुइंग एजुकेशन साइकोलॉजी एज अ सब्जेक्ट। टूडेज टॉपिक इज साइकोलॉजी एज अ डिसिप्लिन। लेट्स start. So students, we are discussing NCERT chapter 1st class 11 psychology. So class 11 psychology chapter 1st is what is psychology, and today's topic is psychology as a discipline. So first we are starting it with a famous quote. The quote is about the psychology. Psychology is a science which aims to give us better understanding and control of the behavior of the organism as a whole. This is a statement made by a famous psychologist, William McDougall. It actually defines the nature of the psychology as a science which is actually talking about the understanding and control of the behavior of the organism. Let us begin the today's topic, psychology as a discipline. Psychology as a discipline. Psychology, whenever we are studying psychology, we are studying behavior, we are studying experiences, we are studying mental processes. We have actually understood it in the previous video. So it seeks to understand and explain how mind works, how different mental processes results in different kinds of behaviors. So as a discipline, we are actually want to study behavior, want to study experiences, want to explain how the mind works, want to explain how the different processes results in the different kind of behaviors. So whenever we are talking about the discipline, psychology must be a multifaceted discipline. It includes the subfields of study areas such as human development, education, sports, health, clinical psychology, social behavior, cognitive process. There are different kinds of faces which this discipline actually represents. We have to understand the discipline, how these faces are working for the development, for the study of psychology as a whole. So, if psychology is as a discipline is a new science, which actually most of the development we are seeing in the last 150 years or so, the advance happening which we are actually studying nowadays are actually result of the researches or the studies conducted in the last 150 years by different psychologists or earlier scientists they are studying. But if we are talking about the origin may be traced back to 405 BC in the ancient Greece, and if we are talking about the ancient Greece, that is 400 to 500 BC, three studies by the three philosophers come into mind, and they are, first one is Socrates, second one is Plato, and third one is Aristotle. Popularly in India it is known as Socrates, Plato and Aristotle. So when we are talking about the Socrates, we are he is between 470 to 399 BC. His student was Plato from 428 to 347 BC, and his student and contemporary is Aristotle, which is 384 to 322 BC. These three philosophers, they have emphasis on philosophy, and the philosophy, the Socrates or the Plato, which is influencing Aristotle, philosophically generally discuss the topics such as memory, free will, attraction, how the psyche or the mind works. They are generally discussing these as a philosophy of those kind, and these are the subjects which current psychologists are also studying. So if we are seeing the psychology in the contemporary, the beginnings of the psychology is rooted in the different kind of philosophies we are seeing. So while psychology did not emerge as a separate discipline until late 1800, beginning of the 19th century and late of the 18th century, we are seeing the psychology as a modern science. During the 7th century, the French philosopher René Descartes introduced the idea of dualism. which is the basis, which becomes the basis of the, which becomes the launching pad for the psychology as a separate discipline. Descartes' idea was also philosophy. Let us see. Idea of dualism asserted that the mind and the body are two entities that interact to form the human experiences. Descartes is actually asserted that mind and the body, they are the dualistic nature, and they are two different entities. They interact, and these interaction results in the human experience. Many issues still debated by the psychology, such as relative contribution of the nature versus nurture, and which is more important, nature is important, the roots or the different kind of biological repercussions are more important for the psychology, or the nurture, the environment is more important for the development of the human psychology. These issues are debated, and these issues are related to actually the philosophical traditions. Next, if we are talking about, so what makes psychology different from the philosophy? If we are seeing it, what makes the different, what makes the difference between the psychology and the philosophy, let us start it. And if we are talking about the philosophy and we are talking about the psychology, so early philosophers, they are actually based on the observation logic, they are not working it empirically. But if we are talking about the modern, so today's psychology, they actually use scientific methods to study, draw conclusion, and therefore it is more empirical than the philosophical study. Earlier, it was dependent on the logic different philosophers are giving. Now, it is based on the empirical study conducted by different psychologists in different areas of study. So, philosophy and psychology. Psychology and if we are talking about the emergence of psychology from the philosophy as a separate science has been the contributed by the physiology, which is a scientific discipline and which has taught us more about our own body. And as physiology contributed to the understanding of processing of the brain, processing of the body, thus psychology has emerged as an empirical study. Early physiological research on the brain and the behavior, they have a dramatic impact on the psychology. Ultimately, the philosophies had left behind, and psychological scientific methodologies are being used to study the human thought and behavior, which contributed immensely to the development of psychology as a separate subject. So psychology emerges as a separate discipline in late 1800. During the mid 1800s, a German physiologist namely William Wundt was using scientific research method to investigate reaction times in the behavior. It has contributed and ignited a separate subject. William Wundt has been named the book which has published in 1874, Principles of Physiological Psychology. It is the major connection between the science of physiology and the study of psychology as a study of human thought and behavior. William Wundt has later opened the world's first psychology lab in 1879. At the University of Leipzig in Germany, and this event is generally considered as the official start of psychology as a separate and distinct scientific discipline. So William Wundt is popularly known as father of psychology because he has officially started psychology as a separate subject in 1879 by establishing first laboratory for the psychological study in Leipzig, Germany. So, what is the view of Wundt for the psychology? If we are studying the view of the Wundt, he perceived the subject as the study of human consciousness and sought to apply experimental methods to studying internal mental processes. So, he specify study of human consciousness, he specify experimental methods, so how these consciousness, internal mental processes can be studied. Secondly, he used a process known as introspection. The introspection is the method he is used to study the internal mental process. Nowadays, we often say that it is unreliable and unscientific. It is not an objective process. It is a subjective process. But the early work which he has started with the introspection actually started, laid the foundation for the future experimental methods used in today's modern psychology. The introspection method, it is a subjective method, but it has actually laid the foundation on which different methods for the study of psychology has been developed, whether it is observation method, whether it is Freud's psychoanalytical method, or different kind of method which we now study, which we now use to study psychology, had been developed on the basis of the introspection method. Next, what are the streams of psychology as a discipline? So psychology is very old knowledge. It is a very young science. It is first laboratory was developed in psychology in 1879. We can often say it as a social science. Why so social science? Because it is studying the social behavior. But in countries, in India or also, it is studies in the faculty of science also. So whether it is a social science or a science, it is the confusion which we have to deal with. So if we are talking about the streams of psychology, it has two parallel streams. One as a science and second as a social science. Science because the methods, they are classified in the science. Social science because the study is being conducted for the society, within society, for the help of society. So these are the two parallel streams of psychology. So stream one, science, and stream two, social science. Why science? The science which makes use of the methods of physical and biological sciences to study various social and psychological phenomena. When we are studying the psychological phenomena, we are actually using the studies, the methods used in physical and biological sciences. Why social science? Because it makes of the methods of social and cultural sciences and subjects to study the various social and psychological phenomena. So these are the two bases on the streams of psychology. Often these streams converge only to drift apart and go their separate ways. They are actually converging to study the psychology, still they are going different separate ways for the study. Let us start them. Let us study them. What is and why and how we are studying under science, and why and how we are studying under the stream called social science. So first we will deal with psychology as a natural science. As a science, psychology considers itself as a discipline which focuses largely on biological principles to explain human. Whether we are studying the Pavlov, whether we are studying the Freud, whether we are studying the Thorndike study, cognitive behaviors of the study of the brain, intelligence study, all these studies actually explain the human behavior on the basis of different biological principles. Therefore, science naturally comes to your mind that this stream psychology may be a science. It assumes that all behavior phenomena have causes which can be discovered if we collect data systematically under controlled conditions. So actually we are talking about the scientific method. If we are studying psychology, we are using the scientific methods. We believe that behavioral phenomena can be discovered if we are collecting data systematically under controlled conditions, experimenting with them, and then we can explain the psychology. So we are using the scientific methods, the physical science, the natural science, we are studying the methods through, we are applying those methods to the psychology as well. Next, we are talking about the aim of the research, that is the cause and effect relationships. So whenever we are studying behavior phenomena, whenever we are studying in the control study of the behavior, we are actually studying the cause and effect relationships, which is the basis of study of the science. So psychology is a natural science. Modern psychology has developed because of the application of the scientific method to study the psychological phenomena. Therefore, psychology should be considered as a science stream. Science places a great deal of emphasis on three things. two things, research and objectivity. So as the psychology, we focus on research and we focus on the objective results of the research, so that whenever we are obtaining it, it gives us two things: consensus on the definition of the concept, and second thing, consensus on how it can be measured. Two things we have to be have consensus on: definition of the concept in the psychology, how this concept can be measured, we should have a consensus on this also. So science, based on three processes: gathering factual information, forming theories to explain this factual information, and testing these theories in the future experiments by other psychologists. So these three are the basis for saying psychology as a natural science, for believing the psychology is a science. Let us see how we can prove it. There are three approaches which uses application of the scientific method. First one is the hypothetical deductive approach, cause-effect relationships we are studying. Second one is the evolutionary approach, how the development, how the psychology evolves. And third one is the ecological approach, how the nature and the nurture, the debate goes on. So these three are the basis, the approaches, basic fundamental approaches on which we are studying psychology, and therefore we are classifying psychology as a science. Let us see these approaches one by one. First approach is hypothetico-deductive approach. So hypothetico-deductive, we are making a hypothesis, we are deducting these hypotheses as correct or true. So psychology, influenced by Descartes and later on by the developments in the physics, has grown by following what is called a hypothetico-deductive model. Influenced by Descartes and later on the scientific principles and the methods used in actually develop this approach, the model suggests that scientific advancement can take place if you have a theory to explain a phenomena. If you have certain theory, if you can explain a phenomena with this theory, then you have a hypothesis in hand. Now you have to deduce whether this hypothesis is true or correct or not in various situations. Therefore, we can proclaim it as a theory, as a rule, or as a principle. So, based on theory, scientists deduce or propose a hypothesis that offers a tentative explanation of how a certain phenomena takes place, and then they actually, hypothesis is tested and proved true or false. And for proving it, we are gathering empirical data, we are revising empirical data in different directions, and we test them for the suggested hypothesis. If it can explain all the aspects of the hypothesis, then we are moving on towards the using the above approach. We are proving it, and we have developed theories of psychologists have developed theories of learning, memory, attention, perception, motivation, emotion. All the significant process by this method have been used by the psychologists to develop different theories in psychology. Till date, most of the research in psychology follows this approach. The most popular approach is hypodeductive approach in the psychology. Second approach, evolutionary approach, we are talking about based on the Darwin's evolution theory. Psychologists have also been considerably influenced by the evolutionary approach, which is dominant in biological sciences. This approach has also been used to explain diverse kinds of psychological phenomena, such as attachment, aggression, and human development, development of the different psychological phenomena. These all psychological phenomena has been developed by evolutionary approach. Evolutionary approach is the theoretical approach to the psychology that attempts to explain useful mental and psychological traits such as memory, perception, language as adaptations, i.e. as the functional products of natural selection. So when we are talking about the emotion, we are talking about the memory, we are talking about the cognition, why the human beings or the different animals are having this? If we want to explain this, we are taking use of the evolutionary theory of the Darwin. Darwin actually classifies natural selection. And if he classifies natural selection, the psychological development is by these psychologists is the result of the functional product of natural selection. Because if we are saying that an ape is coming down from the trees and living on the ground, and he has been developed as a human being in the gradual evolution, and a human being has the cognition of this kind, which is being termed as formal operation by the Piaget, actually we are talking about the evolution of the brain of the human being. So this kind of approach, theoretical approach, is called the evolutionary approach, and various theories have been developed on the memory, on the perception, on the language. They are being developed on the evolutionary approach. In short, evolutionary psychology focused on how evolution has shaped the mind and behavior. Let us move on to the now applicable to any organism with a nervous system. Most research in evolutionary psychology focus on humans. We can talk about any organism on the basis of evolutionary approach, but we are focusing on the human tendencies, human psychology in the evolutionary approach. So evolutionary approach proposes that psychology, that the human brain comprises many functional mechanisms called psychological adaptations or evolved cognitive mechanisms designed by the process of natural selection. So evolutionary psychology actually always proposes that the psychology of the human brain, our human brain, human mechanism, human behavior, all depends upon the process of natural selection. Let us move on. And third approach is ecological approach. This approach focuses on the environmental factors to study different processes of the cognition behavior in the natural setting. So it is an offshoot of the evolutionary process, but still it depends upon, it defines the nurture process, and on the basis of nurture process, how different psychological phenomena can be defined, can be understood, is the ecological approach. So ecological approach emphasizes on the importance of the environment, in particular the perception of how the environment of the organism affords various actions to the organism. Thus, an appropriate analysis of the environment was crucial for the explanation of perceptually guided behavior. So, ecological approach emphasizes if we want to study the behavior, we have to study the environment of the organism residing. If a human being is residing in a tropical rainforest, his behavior is a response to this tropical rain. So, if we are talking about the culture and the impact of society and culture on the psychology, on the behavior of the individual, we are actually studying the ecological approach. So, let us move on. And this approach argues that animals and humans stands in a systems or ecological relations to the environment such that to adequately explain some behavior, it was necessary to study the environment or niche in which the behavior took place. Especially information that epistemically connects the organism to the environment. So, we have to study the systems or ecological relations of the human beings or the animals, then we can epistemically connect the environment to the behavior, and then we can predict which kind of environment, which kind of behavior can be seen in the organism or the human beings. Let us move on. Now we will study psychology as a social science. Let us start. Psychology is recognized more as a social science because it studies the behavior of human beings in their socio-cultural context. Whenever we are studying human beings or any organism, we are actually talking about the socio-cultural context. We cannot study beyond the socio-cultural context. Why we are studying psychology? To understand the human behavior so that we can analyze what is the best socio-cultural psychology which we have to actually develop. We can understand the criminal activities within the society. We can understand the type of responses an individual can make in different situations, and thus we can help the different making of norms, different development within the society according to the psychological aspect. Therefore, psychology becomes a social science because the subject is a social subject. subject of study in psychology is related to the society and culture, therefore psychology is a social science. Psychology as a social science focuses on how behavioral phenomena can be explained in the terms of the interaction that takes place between the person and the socio-cultural context of which he or she is a part. So, it explains the psychological phenomena in terms of relation between the individual, the human being, the organism with its society, culture and environment. Therefore, it is a social science. Humans are not only influenced by their socio-cultural context, they also create them. Psychology as a social science discipline focuses on humans as a social being. Therefore, psychology is a social science because it considers human as a social being and then studies its psychology. Next, we are talking about psychology is a social science which focuses on the individuals and communities in relation to their socio-cultural and physical environment. We are talking about individuals, we are studying communities, but we all are, we as a psychologist, we studying all of them in relation to their social, society, culture, environment. Therefore, psychology is a social science. Next, psychology studies people within society and looks at how a particular society influences how people think and behave. So, we are actually studying the influence of society on the people's thinking and behavior. Therefore, psychology is a social science. It recognizes that behavior is influenced by a person's motives, what is in it for them, and their reactions to the other people and situations, which is the basis of the society. In society, whenever we are talking about the behavior, behavior is always influenced by the other people and the situations, and therefore we have to talk about the behavior in context of situation, that is the society, that is the culture, that is the environment. We have to study, we have to recognize behavior in those contexts. Therefore, psychology is a social science. It is asked questions such as, how do you experience shape our thought and behavior? How do people different social and cultural backgrounds influence the way they might deal with conflict? How does the presence of other people affect our behavior? How does the role we are given affect the way we treat other people? How does peer pressure influence adolescent behavior? These type of questions we are studying in psychology. And every question derives its context from the society, and we have to study the human being as a social being. Therefore, psychology is a social science. Next, we talk about the areas we study, the areas which actually gives the significance of social society. First one is the biological genetical influence. Who we are and how we behave. Is a person born bad or what is the product of their environment? This is often referred to as the nature versus nurture debate. So, whenever we are talking about nature versus nurture debate, Albert Bandura, 1962, believes that aggressive behavior could be learned by observing other people. He called this social learning or modeling. In his social learning or modeling theory, Albert Bandura has actually talked about the different kind of behavior shown by the individual is through observing other people. Therefore, he asserts that psychology is the result of the modeling. Next, we see. So, psychology is a social science which is dependent upon the environment, which is dependent upon the society which we are residing. We move on towards the next topic under the discipline, and that is understanding mind and behavior. Psychology was once defined as a mind. During the 17th century, the French philosopher Descartes introduced the idea of dualism, which asserted the mind and the body were two entities that interact to form the human experience. The term mind has returned to psychology thanks to modern neuroscientists like Sperry and physicists like Penrose. Now we all are again started understanding mind and results it gives the behavior. So these two things we are actually studying. So let's increase the curiosity level, what we are understanding, what we are studying under mind and behavior. Just have a few questions. What is mind? Is it the same as brain? Is it true that mind cannot exist without brain, but mind is a separate entity? is the mind and the brain are same? If the mind is not there, does the brain function same as we are seeing it? Or brain is different from the mind? Let us discuss it. Let us understand it. Whether the mind or the brain are the same or the different things. So, these questions can be appreciated on account of several interesting cases that have been documented. Let's discuss these cases. Through these case studies, we can understand mind as well as the behavior. Case 1. Some patients whose occipital lobe, which are responsible for vision, were surgically removed, have been found to be responding correctly to the location and configuration of the visual cues. It means brain is absent, occipital lobe is absent. Still, they are using their vision because the eyes are sending messages to the brain and brain is responding. Let us take another case. Case 2, an amateur athlete lost his arm in a motorcycle accident but continued to feel an arm and also continued to feel its movement. This phenomena is called phantom arm. When offered coffee, his phantom arm reached out to the coffee cup and when someone pulled it away, he protested. So in the psyche, in the mind, he is believing that he has arm, but his arm is amputated in the accident. This phenomena is called phantom arm. We often see the phantom arm phenomena in certain individuals having accidents and losing limbs. Case 3 is a young man who has suffered brain injury in an accident. After he returned home, see, he said that his parents are replaced by duplicates. They were imposters. So he is recognizing that they are the parents, but he cannot recognizing the behavior and characteristic of the parents. Therefore, he is saying that these are duplicates. They are actually imposter. They are looking like my parents. That means he has the memory of his parents. But he is not believing that his parents has actually developed or evolved and they are old or certain kind of misgivings are suffering. He is observing according to the responses given by the parents and therefore he is believing that they are imposters. In each of these cases, the person has suffered from damage of some part of the brain, but his mind had remained intact. Therefore, we can say that mind is separate from the brain. Brain is functioning, mind is, or psyche is, different. Recent studies in affective neuroscience have clearly shown that there is a relationship between mind and behavior. It has been shown that using positive visualization techniques and feeling positive emotions, one can bring about significant changes in bodily processes. So, now under neuroscience, we are talking about the effectiveness, relationships between mind and behavior, the impact of mind on neuroscience, the impact of positive visualizations for emotions, for bodily processes, for success. We are using this philosophy, this psychology at the next level. So Ornish has actually shown a number of studies with his patients. In these studies, in a person with blocked arteries was made to visualize that blood was flowing through her blocked arteries. After practicing this over a period of time, significant relief was obtained by these patients as the degree of blockage becomes significantly less. So we are actually using these techniques like shown by Ornish to actually help the individuals for physical processes through the psychological processes. Use of mental imagery, i.e. images generated by a person in his or her mind have been used to cure various kind of phobias. In curing phobias and mental illness, we are also using the mental imagery. In racial fears of objects and situations, we are correcting them through the mental imagery. A new discipline called psychoneuroimmunology has emerged, which emphasizes the role played by the mind in strengthening the immune system. So we are seeing different kind of understanding of mind which are now being used in the psychology for different processes. Popular notions about psychology. Now we are studying a next topic under discipline is the popular notions. What is the popular notions and why the psychologists are sometimes called they are the magicians? No, we are not magicians. We are doing a scientific study and we are a student science. We do not have supernatural powers. We have the process through which we are studying human behavior.
Therefore, we can sometime predict the behavior, which is the basis of studying the psychology. Let us understand what is popular notion and what is the psychological scientific notion. Let us start. Every day, almost every one of us act like a psychologist. We try to understand why someone behaved in the manner in which he/she did come in with ready explanation. So, whenever we have to study psychology, what we see that different people say that I can understand the behavior. This person is doing this thing. He is doing so, and he start explaining the basis of the different behavior. He is acting like a psychologist. Not only this, most of us have developed our own theory of human behavior. We want some worker to perform better, she has in the past, we know that we will need to punish her. If we are punishing him, if we are pushing him, thinks that he is a lazy, he is not doing work, and after our punishment or after our pushing, he will do better work. This kind of behavior actually is the popular notion about the psychology. So in fact, you will find that commonsensical explanation of human behavior are based on insight and explained very little. Common sense is based on insight. What happens whenever we are using a thing and we have success, we will say that, this is psychology. If we have failure, then we will say, this is not the psychology. This is the insight we are using in the future perspective. And we are predicting that this kind of implication can be get by this kind of behavior. So, sensical explanations are based on insight. Psychology as a science looks for patterns of behavior which can be predicted and not explained after the behavior occurs, but predicted. Scientific knowledge generated by psychology often runs against common sense. Whenever we are studying, we may say that it is sometimes common sense giving right answers, but whenever we are studying the psychology, we often see that common sense informations are wrongly depicted. Psychology proves them wrong. Let us have some example how we can distinguish between scientific psychology and popular notion about the discipline of the psychology. So, we are differentiating between scientific psychology and popular notion about the psychology. So, scientific psychology is based on the scientific study of psychology. Whereas popular notion uses the common sense to understand any kind of behavior. Under scientific psychology, for understanding the behavior, we are conducting a scientific study. Then we call it a psychological phenomenon. Whereas common sense, we just start understanding, we just start giving knowledge and understanding the behavior. Second thing, scientific psychology explains the psychological phenomena systematically on the basis of empirical data we have conducted through a long research. Whereas, it explains the phenomena on the experiences, sayings or beliefs, that is insight. So, whenever we are talking about popular notion, we have one experience and we may believe that it is correct. We have one saying and we may believe that it is correct. We have acquired belief from our society and culture and we are saying that it is correct. Third is, it studies the patterns of behavior that can be predicted before they occur, whereas popular notions explains events on the basis of insight after they occur. These are the differences between scientific psychology and popular notion. One such example where we can actually see these three things is conducted by Dweck in 1975. He studied children behavior. She was concerned with children who gave up too easily when faced with difficult problem or failure. She wondered how they could be helped. We have often seen in learning that in learning or in practice that the children give up easily when faced with difficult problem or when they are facing failures in certain processes, they give up. So how we can help them? Popular notion, common sense, tells us that initially we will give them easy problems, then we will increase their success rate. As the confidence goes up, we will start giving them different difficult problems, and gradually we will increase the difficulty so that they can solve the problems, difficult problems also, with the confidence they are carrying from the previous successes. Dweck's study tested this, whether this common sense is correct or whether this common sense is wrong. Let us see what are the results of Dweck study? Dweck took two groups. The experiment, the study was conducted on two groups who were trained for 25 days in solving mathematical problems. So he has taken two groups. One is control group, one is experimental group. The first group was given easy problems which they were always able to solve, and there gradually we are giving them difficult problems. Whereas the second group has a mix of easy and difficult problems. Obviously, in case of difficult problems, they failed. Whenever this happened, Dweck told them that their failure was because they do not try hard enough and persuaded them not to give up and keep trying. Under one group, he is giving easy problems. Under second group, he is giving mix of easy and difficult problems. Easy problems they are solving and difficult problems they are failing. But Dweck is actually, whenever they fail, she is saying them, you are not tried, try again, and persuaded them and not to give up and keep trying. What was the result? After the training period was over, a new set of mathematical problems were given to the two, both groups. Now this is difficult than the previous problems. What he is saying, Dweck found that against the common belief, those who had always succeeded because they were given easy problems gave up much faster. They gave up easily whenever they are facing the problems. But those second group who has the experience of both success and failures and were taught to attribute their failure to the lack of effort, they are actually conducting, they were many others, they are actually conducting their efforts again and again so that they should give success, they should have success. So the common notion is wrong. If we are giving the mixed problems, then they are making more efforts, we have seen. So whenever we are seeing, there are many other common sense notions which you may not find to be true, like the popular notions. Not too long ago, we believed that men are more intelligent than the women, but empirically we have shown that both have the same kind of intelligence. Both have intelligent woman and man, both have less intelligent man and woman, so both of them are untrue. Similarly, when psychologists start predicting behavior, they are considered as the future tellers. Psychologists are different from astrologers, tantrics and palm readers, because they systematically examine propositions based on data to develop principles about human behavior and other psychological phenomena. So popular notion about the discipline psychology is wrong. Psychology is a definite science which studies the social aspects. Therefore, it is a social science. We study human behavior, we study psychological phenomena, we study scientifically.
So friends, this was the topic, psychology as a discipline. I hope you all people have understood it well. Thanking all of you watching this video. We will meet again. For the time being, namaskar, take care of you.